In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. It is very good to be home, even if it's just for a few minutes. But it is good to see so many of you and to see the young FOI and MGT flowering into great young men and women for the cause of Islam. There's so much going on and there's so much to say to you. I'll try to get over all of the points that I have to say. First, I got a call last night about nearly midnight from Washington, D.C. Minister Alim was on the phone, and he had good news and bad news. And the bad news was that he lost the election, and I don't consider it at all a loss. I wanted him to know that, and I wanted us to know that.
Yes, sir.
He made a very, very significant showing, and there are factors that will come out that we already know about the corruption of the political system. But they had judges, from what I was told today, pulling the levers. And many of the polling, voting machines weren't working. And you know the whole, you know the stuff that they do.
Right.
So they probably robbed the brother of the victory. Muslims and Christians and activists were working together in a tremendous effort that they put forward. And though some of the workers who worked so hard, you know, with very little money and whatnot, felt a sense of disappointment, there really is nothing to be disappointed about. I think Thomas Edison, they say, failed many times before he got this electric light bulb. And to me, there is no failure in Islam. We may not succeed at what we wish to succeed at when we wish to succeed at it, but we know we're going in the right direction, and with the help of Allah, we keep going.
Yes, sir.
And we will get a voice in Congress. If not in September, then in November. And if not in November, then 2 years from now, where we will have time to prepare adequately for this kind of race. I don't want any of you to be disappointed. And Minister Alim called and asked me to please thank all of you for your prayers, for your good wishes, for the charity that you gave in this effort. Again, there's so many good things that have happened as a result of just the brothers announcing that they're running. And I felt it all over the country. Wherever I went, politicians who treated me as though I had leprosy or AIDS, all of a sudden found me attractive. And they began coming out to the meetings, sitting on the rostrum with me, hoping to get me to say something kind about them. This is positive, because it's the preachers, the politicians, and the educators who are the number one holdups of the rise of our people. And when you get these three classes of persons interested and speaking the truth, then the rise of our people is absolutely assured. So we have made a step in the right direction. So I don't want any of you to be dispirited or downhearted. So I thought I would tell you that right off. Second thing I'd like to say is I heard from Sister Farrakhan today and Brother Akbar and Sister Maria last night, and they send you all the greetings. Sister Farrakhan is in Ghana with Brother Akbar, and they are having a wonderful time. They stopped my daughter in Egypt, and they didn't want to let her pass through with an American passport because they just knew she was not a black American. She was an Egyptian faking it, you know. So my wife had to let them know that no, she's my daughter and she definitely is a black American, and her father is a black American, and certainly I am. Right. So they finally let her get out of Egypt into West Africa. Today is the 37th anniversary of Brother Farrakhan and his wife, and and I sincerely hope that you that are about to marry, thinking about marriage, or have jumped into it already, will find the woman or the wife or the husband of your choice and try your best to make a good and lasting, meaningful marriage. There's so many things in this life that we are tested by that can interfere with our hopes and dreams in each other. And sometimes our hopes get so dashed that divorce becomes a reality. But if we can weather the storms of marriage, and in every marriage there are storms, none of us are perfect. And since we are not perfect in our duty to Allah, then we will not be perfect in our duty one to the other. And if we can have the mind and the spirit to forgive one another as we are bound to ill effect each other from time to time, but to carry this until it sets up bitterness and even hatred is, of course, to destroy the bond which makes marriage work, and that is the bond of love. And so my wife called me from Ghana because I didn't know how to reach her to wish me a happy anniversary and to send the greetings to you. This also is the 13th year of our rise, second rise, to rebuild the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It happened 13 years ago around this very time. And because of that significant motion that took place 13 years ago, we are here.
Yes, sir.
Tonight in this wonderful, magnificent edifice. And I thank Allah for each and every one of you, for your sacrifices that have made these 13 years very, very, very productive years. Of course, I heard my son say that the biggest room is room for improvement. And I know that there's much room for improvement. And all of us, I'm hoping, will set our minds to the task of improving ourselves and improving the quality of our service to Allah and to our people. Now, this 13 years is something that we must look into. And tonight, for just a few moments, I want to talk to us about mission. What is a mission? In warfare, oh, by the way, before I get into that, I received a fax about 10 days or so ago inviting me to Saudi Arabia to meet with Islamic leaders from around the earth who were meeting in Mecca to look at the Gulf crisis, to see what kind of solution we could effect. And I had intended to be there. I was in Seattle, Washington on Saturday and spoke for 3 hours, believe it or not, which is not easy or difficult for you to believe it. I think you know those kind of lectures very well. And it was one of those 3 hour nights. And then we went immediately to the hotel room, took a shower, changed clothes, and ran to the airport and flew all night long to be in Washington. And we got to Washington the next morning at 11 o'clock. And we rushed to make an appearance with Minister Alim at two churches and then to hold a press conference. And then at 5:30, I was to be on an airplane going to Saudi Arabia. And somehow, Brother Leonard had the tickets and he was in Los Angeles and got sick and missed the flight. And so there I was in Washington. And then I found out that the Saudi embassy could not guarantee me space on Saudi Airlines, even though we had a ticket, so we would have to go to New York and take an Egypt Airlines plane, fly to Cairo, and then on into Jeddah. And I said, thank you very much. I'm going back home. And I said, if y'all wanted me in Mecca, you'd have made arrangements for me to get there. And the moment I made the decision to come back to Chicago, I started feeling better. Everybody around me felt better and that it was the right thing to do. We are in a very, very difficult period, brothers and sisters. This is not a lightweight thing that is going on in the Gulf. And I have endeavored to hold my tongue to see what Allah would show me with respect to this, because I'm very troubled by it. And I know when Allah is desirous of giving me a message, He troubles me about something, and I can't seem to figure out what it is until I go and get quiet. And when I get quiet, I begin listening, and then pieces of things will come together. It was around this very time last year that I received a call from Phoenix, Arizona, congratulating me on my anniversary. And I said, oh yes, my wife and I have been married for 36 years. And they said, no, I was not speaking of that. I was congratulating you on the fourth year of the anniversary of your vision. And that very word triggered in my mind that the vision was not yet over, but the vision was a continuing vision with guidance in it that is magnificent. And even as I thought that I understood fully now that there was an attack coming on black people with Louis Farrakhan as the focus, and you know I held the press conference in Washington and accused President Bush, and then went on a national tour, and I have not stopped, warning our people all over the country. And now, in the last 6 weeks, here's President Reagan, Colin Powell, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, a Muslim nation, and he's planning a war. And if you listen to every word that the president is speaking, he is not saying anything about a hope for a political solution to that problem.
That's right.
I hear nothing out of his mouth that would even suggest that Mr. Bush is seeking hopes for and will work for a political solution. If you notice the role that Egypt was alleged or was supposed to play in the war against Libya, Egypt backed down. And the role that Egypt is now playing in the Gulf area, it's just the reverse. So this is a very serious matter. So I have to go back to the vision, look at it again, because it is revealing exactly what things are happening before it happens. And there's another thing that I yet have to do, and I'm troubled because I'm not sure of it yet. So if I get quiet, I'm sure Allah will show me. And I seriously want to say to all of us, this is not something we run around talking about, because when the Muslim world goes to war with the wicked, then it's a serious time for all of us who call ourselves Muslims.
That's right.
And there is a scripture that says, he who keepeth his mouth in that day will save his soul. So I thought I should say that, and hopefully by the 28th of September, if it is the will of Allah, I will have had hopefully that kind of communication that would make me crystal clear on our role from this point on. I watched bits and pieces of Mr. Bush last night, and I've never seen Mr. Bush like that. I've always seen him calm and every word measured, because he felt he had Russia to deal with. But now that Russia is no longer the major threat, he appears to be a man that feels that there is no power anywhere able to stop him. And he speaks now differently than pardon me, I have heard him speak. And certainly in this joint session before Congress, he was displaying this newfound power. And he feels very good about the world uniting behind his lead. And he's talking about a new world order, and he sees himself as the leader of this new world order. And you know, if you pump up a balloon with too much air, and I'm watching this and studying the Quran at the same time, seeing what I may see. And I think Allah is showing me a lot, but I don't want to speak ahead of time. But suffice it to say, brothers and sisters, it's a very dangerous hour for the world, for the entire world. And even though Iraq looks like easy pickings, Iraq may be, but Allah is not. And any general that studies warfare can only calculate on what he knows. He cannot calculate on the unknown. And therefore, no general can calculate properly when you're dealing with Allah. So he may calculate the strength of Iraq as opposed to the world's uniting against Iraq, but he does not yet know why God permitted Iraq to be raised up. He doesn't know God's purpose for this nation.
That's right.
He does not know what it means in the Quran when it says, Maliki Yawmiddin, Master of the Day of Judgment.
Yes, sir.
If Allah is Master of the Day of Judgment, then he's moving all the pieces on the chessboard. Ain't no piece on the board that escapes his vision or his power.
Yes, sir.
So he's moving the pieces to bring about his will. So the pieces may feel that they are moving themselves. While the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to us of Allah, and now I'm speaking of the great Mahdi who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, that this being is so powerful that he can turn your brain to thinking and doing as he pleases. You know, white folk have mastered it to a degree, turning your mind and making you do what they want you to do. But they never thought they would meet a master who could turn their minds,
yes, sir,
and make them do what he desires them to do. And that's why the Quran says, and they planned.
That's right.
And Allah planned.
Yes, sir.
And Allah, of course, is the best of planners. So there is much that is going to happen in the world that will bring about danger. And the result ultimately is going to be our deliverance. But the Quran says that Allah delivered Moses and Aaron in a time of great distress. And that's when you are delivered, mothers, when you are having your children. Not before distress, but in a time of great distress is when you are delivered. I happened to be at class one Saturday. They blessed me to be at the class this Saturday, and I saw a baby delivered not an actual baby, of course, but it sounded like the real thing to me. They went through the motion, boy, and that was some distress that sister was manifesting, and everybody that has ever had a baby in the class understood that distress. And so in a time of distress, Allah will deliver his people. So don't worry about distress and affliction. When you see great distress coming to us, know that the time of delivery is right near. Okay? We're clear, aren't we?
Yes, sir.
Now, that's not what I wanted to talk to you about tonight. But I thought I would just say these things that you may watch the news. Study the newspaper. All of you, keep up with world events.
Yes, sir.
Don't let a day go by that you don't study what is going on in the world and try to read the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, particularly his writings in the fall of America and our Savior has arrived. And then, and of course, the study guides also. And then as you read these events, see what you can read into it. Okay? And as you go out selling tickets for the September the 28th event, people want to know, what is Farrakhan saying about this Iraq situation?
Yes, sir.
Tell them Farrakhan will have a lot to say about it on the 28th.
That's right.
And don't miss it. Now, mission. In the word mission, it comes from the Latin root mittere, which means to send. When one is on a mission, one has been sent to do a specific thing of great importance. And certainly in warfare, the generals plan the battle, and they have certain groups that carry out certain mission. And the success of this mission could mean the success of the overall battle or war. Sometimes the whole effort of war depends on the success of one or two strategic missions. Whenever a person has a mission which is a duty or a function, the person or persons have to be carefully chosen that they will give themselves totally to the mission and will not weaken under the stress and the strain that attends a mission, particularly a mission of great importance. So in the scriptures, the Bible talks about God searching the hearts of the people and choosing the right person to send on a specific mission of great importance. Every prophet is a man raised and a man sent. And when the prophet is sent, he is sent with a mission. And that mission is the sum total reason or purpose of the man's existence in the world. In fact, those who are chosen for that kind of mission, they were chosen before they were conscious. that there ever was such a thing as a mission. Do you follow what I'm saying? The scriptures of the Bible puts it like this. Before you were formed in the womb of your mother, I chose you. I, in words, called you before you were formed to be a prophet unto the nations. That's powerful, brothers and sisters. This means that those who are truly sent cannot escape what they are born into the world to do. And the sad thing about the life of one who is sent is that that person does not know until a certain time in his or her development that they were born to do this or that. So they may marry, and they may find when they get the mission that their wife was not up to a man of that kind of importance. Lot had a wife like that.
Yes, sir.
She just wasn't up to it. You know what I mean? She married the man. She didn't know he was a prophet. She thought she had married a man. She's going to settle down and sit by the fireplace and, you know, have a nice, regular life. Until God got in the picture and sent the angels to the man to tell the man, that ain't what you here for. You here for this. Now go and warn the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. Once the man who is born for the mission meets the mission, it is love at first sight. And the marriage takes place, and the man and the mission become one. So the only reason for the man's existence, the only thing that makes his life meaningful or with purpose, is that he at last has found what God has desired for him to do. So now everything that is around that person is measured by their commitment to that which he is born into the world to do. So the Quran says, Muhammad is not the father of any of your men. He is the messenger of Allah and the seal of the prophets. It didn't mean that he did not have children. Do you follow what I'm saying? The value of a mission and a man in a mission is that you must relate to the mission in order to relate to the man. Now that is serious.
Yes, sir.
Now, what is your point, Minister Farrakhan? And I don't wish for you to think when I use the personal pronoun I am, I was speaking in the place of Muhammad. I am the messenger of God. Muhammad speaking, not Farrakhan. Muhammad saying, I am the messenger of God. Yes, I am your father. But unless you relate to my mission, you do not relate to my ability to father you. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad produced children. But unless those children related to his mission, then he could not father them. Do you understand? I wonder. Because to father somebody is to further them in the development of themselves along certain lines. Your physical father put the germ there and got us here. Well, he's our father. But how much fathering of us did the father actually do? Probably very little. But now God has taken over the role that your father should have played and raised up a man from among us to be a messenger of God for us. Yes, and that messenger is a spiritual father to us. And when we relate to him as the messenger, yes, then we relate to his mission, and his mission is our elevation. So in that elevation, he becomes a father to the fatherless. Do you understand? Many of you that have no father have related to me in that light. And many of you that have never lived one day with me see me as more your father than your father.
Yes, sir.
Is that right?
That's right.
I don't claim that, but you see me as that because in reality, that is my mission.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes,
now, I'm coming to something.
Yes, sir. Take your time.
Look, when it is time for planting, there is a certain work that has to be done. Time says it's time to plant. Then we must produce the worker that will come up and prepare the ground first for the reception of the seed. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
The ground has been covered in winter. It's cold and the ground is hard. So we have to churn the earth.
Yes, sir.
Turn it over, make it supple and ready to receive the seed.
Yes, sir.
I don't know anything about farming, but those of you who know farming, you know that that's the process.
That's right.
After you turn the earth over, break it up, break up these clods in the earth, now she is ready to receive the seed. Is that right?
Right.
When you put the seed down, you come back again and the seed is covered over.
That's right.
With the earth. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Then if you don't have an irrigation system, you wait for the rain to come. And then you watch for the things, the pests that will come to destroy your crop. Is that right?
That's right.
Then when it's time for harvest, the time says it's harvest time. You look, you see the fruit or the vegetables ripening, then somebody has to take up the job of harvesting. But time has to produce the person who has the duty, the obligation, or the mission. We're together.
Yes, sir.
Now, you've heard the saying, what time is it? Time. If you read the time, brothers and sisters, the time will tell you what kind of man and work is needed to be done and what kind of man is needed to work the work that needs to be done. What time is it? Very briefly, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad says that we are at the time of the end of the white man's power of rule and authority over the darker people of the earth, and specifically over you and me. Well, is that true? Well, if it's time for a certain thing to take place, you begin to see a sign of it.
Yes, sir.
When a young man or young woman is coming to puberty, that's time. Saying, uh-oh, something new is happening, then you should see a sign of it. Uh-oh, I got a little hair under my arm. Uh-oh, some sign saying change is going on. Now it demands a different kind of action and approach.
Yes, sir.
By the person watching the time.
Yes, sir.
Well, if it's time for the rise of black people then you're going to see signs in black people that it's time. What signs do we see in our people to let you know that white folk can't rule us no more? What do you see?
Rebellion.
You see rebellion, exactly right. You don't want to go to school and listen to this foolishness no more. You go to school, sit down, and hear the teacher, and the teacher don't make no sense to you. Made sense to your mother, made sense to grandma, but make very little sense to you because something is bubbling in you. You need something different, but you're not getting it in school. So you pay more attention to the rap than you do to the rap of the teacher. Because as far as you're concerned, the teacher ain't rapping at all. Out of step, out of time. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir.
Rebellion is taking place, letting you know that the institutions that held power over the minds of the people are weakening in their ability to hold the people. That's telling you it's time now for a change.
Yes, sir.
When it is time for a change, time produces the man who will bring the change about.
Yes, sir.
In Sandersville, Georgia, a child was born. It looked like an ordinary child. But as the child began to grow, the mother knew this was a strange child. She had many children. This was the seventh child, and very strange. She named the child Elijah. Elijah, and their slave name was Pooh. And she brought little Elijah to church, but little Elijah was sitting in the church watching his daddy as a preacher, but seeing something different. Elijah was a child of destiny. When he moved from Macon, Georgia to Detroit, Michigan, the poor man was disillusioned.
Yes, sir.
And in disillusionment, the person who has a mission may do strange things during that period of disillusionment. They may take drugs. They may be involved with a lot of women. They may get drunk and be a drunkard. You say that, look at that jab nigga. Look at just drinking all the time. Oh, he's a gambler. He's this. But you don't know that that person has a date with destiny. But the thing that they're involved in shows that they're not happy and they're bothered. And then one day they hear a word, like they come to the mosque,
yes, sir,
and sit on the front row like you did. And they hear it. Others are listening to it also.
That's
but
right.
They don't hear it like this person. This person hears it and comes alive immediately. Say, oh, this is what I've been looking for all my life. Uh-huh. Now, all right, good. Now you hear, what have I got to do to be a part of this? Then you say, oh, I got to clean up my life. And that becomes easy. You throw down the whiskey. You throw down the wine. You throw down the reefer. You put down the sisters. You put down the brothers. You get yourself together. Well, what's happening to you? A change is taking place in you now. Your mother begins to look at you and say, what's happening to my son? What's happening to my daughter? My daughter ain't the same anymore. They must be brainwashing them down at that place. Stay away from that place. Do you hear me? If you go near that place again, I'll put you out of my house. I'll throw you in the street. You can't go down there and hear that Farrakhan no more. But you hear all of that and you say, well, Ma, I don't care what you say. I know I found the truth. Your mother said, well, if you go there, you're out of here. Say, well, I'm just out of here then. When you find yourself developing the strength to walk out on your mother, walk out on your father, walk out on your sister, walk out on your brother, walk out on your wife, walk out on your husband, walk out on your family, walk out on all the things of yesterday, and something is moving you now.
Yeah.
It's bigger than you. It's bigger than you. It is as though you were a seed laying dormant, and finally you heard the right word, the right thing, and you began to blossom. And in your blossoming, those around you don't understand what's happening with you because they didn't know what you were born for in the first place. There are many people that grew up with you and say, well, I knew you were kind of strange, you know, when we were growing up. You was always talking all that old black stuff. And when we was growing up, you always had a different kind of mind. And your own brother or sister will say, yeah, nigga, I know you was crazy from the beginning. I watched you, you know. You would be sitting there. We would be looking at TV. And nigga, you be crying over something somebody did to some old jive nigga. And I'm, well, now I know what was wrong with you. In a family, God don't pluck the whole family. He may pluck one person out of a whole family. And when he plucks you, the rest of the family say, oh, the nigga done went crazy. And they turn their back on you, but you don't care. That's when you know you're born for something. When you can walk out and don't care what people say, don't care what they do. You found what you've been looking for, and I'm dead on course now. That don't mean they're not ups and downs. That doesn't mean they're not disappointments. But what it does mean, you have found what you were born for.
Yes, sir.
And if you turn your back on what you're born for, then God begin to whip you until you get your act together, because he's not going to let you go until you do what you're born to do.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Isn't that something about Allah? You read about Jonah in the Bible.
Yes, sir.
That Jonah trying to run from what God had for him to do. Just hanging out. Partying. God said, Jonah, I love you, but you sure messing up. Jonah's running.
Yes, sir.
Jonah jumps on a ship. God said, uh-huh. He sends a storm. Everybody on the ship praying. God don't hear nobody. Jonah's in the bottom of the ship sleep. They wake him up, say, man, a storm, pray. He said, oh, it's nothing but God. He's after me. He's after me, boy. He don't even let me rest at night. I'm trying to sleep, and he rocking my boat. And rocking the boat only means that wherever you go, when you try to run from your mission, see, God will rock your boat.
Yes, sir, that's right.
You'll be sleeping, thinking everything is all right. He'll send a storm and rock your boat. Don't nobody know why your boat is being rocked, but when they wake you up, you know exactly why you're in trouble. You're in trouble because you're running from something God wants you to do.
Yes.
And until you make up your mind, God, I surrender. I'm through fighting you. I'm through running. I submit to the Lord of the worlds.
Yes.
From that point on,
yes,
there'll be trials. Yes, there'll be tribulations. But now you have come home to your mission. And the mission and the man become one. The mission and the woman become one. Inseparable.
Yes, sir.
And maybe you got a mate that ain't right. Maybe the mate don't want you in no mission. Well, you try like Lot, you know, baby, we can make it. I better take a drink of water on that. But sometimes it doesn't work. So we have to be separated from these weights that drag you down.
Yes, sir.
And then you need to find a mate that will not only marry you, but marry the mission.
Yes, sir.
That God has birthed you into the world to do. Now, coming to that point in our little short talk, I come now to the words of Jesus when he says to his disciples, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. And then he says, take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Why is your yoke easy, Jesus? Because I was born to do what I'm doing. And therefore, it's not a burden to me. It fits me well. When one is born to sing, they sing effortlessly.
Yes, sir.
It does not mean that they don't have to practice. It does not mean that they won't fail sometimes in their effort. But what it does mean is that what you're born to do is not a burden. It's easy. And the burden is light because you're born to do exactly what you're doing. And when you're born to do it, you love to do it. And when you're born to do it and you love to do it, you draw life from doing what you're born to do. And you give life by doing what you're born to do.
Yes, sir.
When you listen to Luther Vandross.
Yes, sir.
Oh, the man is a singer. He's not just a singer, he's a singer's singer. Anybody who knows anything about singing will listen to Luther Vandross and say, now that's my man. The man can sing.
That's right.
And to listen to him, he does it effortlessly. Sick or well, it makes no difference. I mean, the man can sing.
That's right.
And you can tell that he loves doing it. And since he loves to sing, when he sings, he makes us love his singing, and he is infused with life by our acceptance of his song. See? Well, so it is with a person born with a mission. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad is the most special human being that ever lived.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to say that again.
Yes,
the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was and is the most special human being that ever lived.
Yes, sir.
Why do you say that, Brother Farrakhan? Because once every 25,000 years, there is a change. Once every 50,000 years, there is a universal change.
That's right.
When there is a universal change, there's a man born of universal magnitude to bring about that kind of change. But this is not just a universal change. This is the manifestation of the will of him who originated the heavens and the earth over 72 trillion years ago. Then a man would be born to perfect his creation. Good God Almighty.
Work with us.
Now, I want you to think now. When God consistently in the Quran uses the soft pronoun we,
yes, sir,
and we adorned the lower heaven with stars, and we did this and we did that, who is this we? God doing all right creating the heavens and the earth. When it comes to man, he said, let us make man. So there is now a group of like-minded persons accepting a duty and a mission directed by a supreme director, and those persons are saying, and we adorned the lower heaven with stars. God is talking with his agents of work.
Yes, sir.
In his company, and we did this. And had we wished to take a pastime from before ourselves, we would have done it. Nay, we cast truth at falsehood till we knock out its brains. We who? Who is the we? As in the beginning, Allah created himself. As the Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us, out of total triple darkness, and created us out of that darkness. And then he said, we. He said, the powers of the heavens and the earth are from us, the original people. Now, as it was in the beginning, so it is now in this time of universal change. There has to be one raised and one sent.
Yes, sir.
And that one must now raise a people that will accept the mission and say, and we did such and so, and we will do such and so. So, I mean, this is not for everybody. This is just for the few who are called and chosen and born to do this work.
Yes, sir.
Now, but what is the work? What is the work? Look, if it's time for the white man to sit down, the white man is not going to sit down until the next ruler stands up.
All right. Come on, talk to us.
You don't expect the white man to just say, well, yes, my time is up. I'm leaving. Thank you very much. Adios. No. The white man is not going no place until his replacement is in place to challenge him for the place.
Come on.
How can you challenge anybody for your rightful place if you are dead to the knowledge of yourself and your place? So somebody has to come to raise you and me from the dead.
Yes, sir.
That's the first work.
Yes, sir.
Raise the black man up. I don't care what you're doing, what your particular work is, that work is not more important than the work that God and the messenger wants to put upon us. Don't you dare put your profession, I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, I'm a teacher, I'm an accountant, I'm a business person, I'm a banker, I'm a lawyer, I'm a this. Wait a minute, I didn't call you to no damn law, no business, no bank. What the hell is that to the work that is in front of us? I want you to listen to me good.
Yes, sir.
All of that is good, but it is secondary.
Yes, sir.
The first work is to raise the dead. Well, what does that mean? Do I have to give up my role as a banker or as a book, not a bookmaker, but maybe that too. A bookkeeper, a certified public accountant, a teacher. Should I give up my work? I didn't say that. But what I am saying is that you must recognize that your work is not more important than the mission of the resurrection of the dead. What you got is a job that a white man put you on. What the hell is that? But to keep the white man's world up, you got a job. He gives you money to keep you going in his world. God wants to build a new world. See, out of you and me, somebody got to take up the mission. And many of us are running. We know the truth, but we're running from the duty. Yeah, well, I mean next week, you know, later, yes. Next year, you know, when I get some money, I'll be back to carry on this work. But right now, man, I got to make me some money. You know what I mean? I'll give me some money. Right, we got to all have some money. But Allah promised money,
yes,
good homes, friendship,
in all walks of life. But he said you must do the first work, and the first work is the resurrection of our people. I was a musician, and I think I was pretty good. Well, not say anybody would say that about themselves, but I thought I was pretty good. I had a lot of talent in the field of music, but I had to give it up to accept the mission. Now that was very painful, because music was my life. I knew nothing but music. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, "That's fine, brother. I wasn't in the mosque 30 days before a decree came down from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It's either music or me." And all the rest of the musicians in the mosque left the mosque. I was the only one that stayed and gave it up and chose the messenger and the mosque over the music. And I didn't know where I was going. I didn't know what I was going to do for work, because I wasn't trained in any other field but music. And you would have laughed to see me loading trucks. Didn't even know how to pick the thing up. I had strength. But if you don't know how to do what you do, you look crazy. And I was the craziest looking worker you've ever seen in your life. I got fired from every job. It wasn't because I was late. I worked hard, but I didn't work good. Your little brother was cleaning toilets. This is the truth, man. I didn't care what the job was. I wanted to take care of my family.
Yes, sir.
I was not going to steal, but I knew I had to work. White folks had jobs. I didn't know how to make a job for myself, so I went to work. That's what everybody got to do. If you can't make a job for yourself, you must find a job. But the job should not be the number one thing on your mind. The number one thing on your mind should be what you have accepted, the truth. And to look at your people out there suffering and saying, "Oh, we got to raise our people up from this terrible condition." And everyone must be committed to that work.
Yes, sir.
That's the work that makes all other work meaningful. But without the work of the raising of our people, no other work is significant. What are you going to tell Allah? You know, I'm a banker, Allah. I'm a doctor. You know, I was busy in the operating room. You mean to tell me I gave you some truth, and these people out there dying for the lack of knowledge, and you put that work above my work that I called you to do? Think about how you're going to answer. A word that raised you up, cleaned you up, stood you up, made you up. Now you too busy?
Come on.
To help your brother get up?
Come on.
Don't you love for your brother what you love for yourself?
Yes, sir.
Of course you do. But you're running from your duty. Many of us just running, skipping, ducking, dodging, dancing. Okay. I want to close, because I don't want to, you know, wear you out on myself. But brothers and sisters, God knew that it's time for a change. And he wants us to lead the change. And look at Reagan. There's going to be a new world order. Bush. And Bush is taking your place. He wants to lead the world order.
Yeah.
God is saying, I chose the black man.
Yeah.
Well, he chose the black man. Look what your brothers and sisters are doing. They're boogieing, they're partying, they're rapping, they're dancing, they're popping. They don't even know that they're chosen. Why don't they know? The scripture says, how can they know except they have a teacher? And how can they have a preacher except he be sent? Somebody has to give somebody a mission.
Yes,
And somebody has to accept the mission, become one with the mission. And the mission is the person's reason for living. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, one day I was playing a play that I had written called Organa, a Negro spelled backwards. And we were at Dunbar High School. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad slipped out of 4847 South Woodlawn and slipped into the balcony to see Brother Farrakhan playing and singing and dancing. And oh, I was having a ball. And they told me my leader and teacher was up in the balcony. I really showed out, you know. And the next morning, I got word that he wanted to see me for breakfast. Now, in my play, there was a beautiful black sister, Muslim, who played the part of a prostitute. There was a brother who played the part of a homosexual, you know, in the play. And we were showing how the teachings, you know, straightens up everybody. And there was a song that I sang called Look at My Chains. I collaborated with others to write this song, Look at My Chains, and I recorded the song. And it's a very sad, sad song. It's about slavery, and I came out, you know, in my chains. And I remember my daughter, you know, Betsy Jean, your captain, when she was a little girl, I was playing this in Symphony Hall in Boston, Massachusetts. And she was sitting in the audience and saw her father come out in these chains, you know, and I was playing that thing jam up. She got up out of the chair, run down the aisle to come get her father out these chains, you know. Her aunt had to come and grab her, tell her, no, daddy's not in them chains. This is a play, you know. But to her, I was playing that thing too real. My daddy up in them chains. So anyway, when we did it at the Dunbar High School, the messenger called me to the home. And the next day, I had coffee with him. And he took me into the living room and he said, brother, he said, I enjoyed the performance last night. I was all bubbly. Thank you, dear Holy Apostle. And I know how you feel by me, because God has blessed a ratio, you know, to be that I was by him as you are by me. And just for him to be pleased with what I was saying just inspired me.
Yes, sir.
But then he came with the next word. He said, brother, in your play, he says, your play will probably make one day about $16 or $17 million for the nation, your play and your songs. He said, but he said, I don't want ever to see any of my sisters playing the part of a prostitute. He said, in order to act in such way, you have to put your mind in such way. And it's so difficult to raise our people up from that condition, that if you cause them to act like that, you are sending them back into that which I'm trying to raise them from. That was very heavy, heavy. And then the brother that was playing the homosexual, he definitely never wanted to see a man play that part. He said, because when one is a homosexual, it takes God himself to turn you back around and make you what he originally intended. That's for the male and the female. You cannot come out of homosexuality without the help of God, nor can you come out of drugs without the help of God. So if
the mission of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was the reform of our lives. He certainly did not want me producing a play that had our people playing the same part that he's trying to get us to come out of. Do you follow what I'm saying? And then he said, brother, I really like your song. He said, you had everybody in the audience crying. And then he said, you know, brother, one day I was teaching in Detroit, and my subject was the prodigal son. And when I finished teaching, everybody in the audience was crying. And when I got home, Master Farad Muhammad asked me, how did I do? And before I could answer, one of the other guests said, oh, he did so well. He taught so today that everybody was just crying. And Master Farad Muhammad said to him, brother, don't make my people cry. He said, they have cried enough. I have come to wipe away their tears. And so he told me that when I did something, it should be to uplift the people and not to put them in the position of remorse and grief and sadness. And then he got to the punchline. Well, he was working on the punchline all along. And guess what the punchline was? The punchline was, Brother Farrakhan, I would like you to give up this music all together. All together. No more. He said, I know that you are good at it. I know. And you think that this is what you were born for. He said, but you have a spiritual side that this side will keep you from getting acquainted with. He said, your mission, your work is spiritual. Give this up. And I promised him right then and there that I would give up my music. And what I did, I went into a recording studio and I recorded the songs. And when I sent him the recording of the songs, he was angry. The next time he saw me, I thought you told me you were going to give up this thing. I said, I did, dear apostle. I just went into a recording studio to record it, that we might have it. But I'm through with it. He said, well, all right then. He never said the music was good. That was the end of that. Now, I'm not saying that to you, Sister Patricia, or to others. Give up your music. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is, get on with the mission.
Yes, sir.
The mission is not singing. The mission is not dancing. The mission is getting the message of life to a dead people that they may come up to do that which Allah wants them to do.
Yes, sir.
That's the mission. When I gave up music, I did not know where I was going to turn. I was a minister then, but I was singing and ministering, playing and ministering. And I mean, the mosque was full of people. And I don't know whether they were coming for the singing, the dancing, the playing, or the ministry. But I know when I stopped playing and singing, the mosque
you know, kind of narrowed a little bit. Because people get frightened when you get too serious. And it looks, see, a mission and a person committed to a mission is like a slave. And our experience in slavery has been so bad, we don't ever want to be perceived as a slave again. So we run from a duty that binds us. Have you noticed that you can come to the mosque and you get involved in the work and then you get frightened? Oh, what's happening to me? I'm changing so fast and nobody recognizes me. I'm doing what everybody else is telling me to do. It's like I'm losing my personality. And you get frightened because it's like somebody else is taking you over and you're not sure of whether this is right or wrong, and you get frightened and you step back. All of a sudden you don't come out anymore for a while. You back up and start hanging out with your old friends and getting back into your old habits. And then all of a sudden God will come and smack you upside the head. Mop! Oh hell, I'll go back and slip in around the mosque.